Hi there! In this tutorial, we're gonna create an island group generator in SVG. The islands have sandy, grassy, and woody parts, while the waters near are azure blue, but in the open, they are deep blue. Let's dive in! This is the layout I will be working with. The left panel is the code editor, and the right panel is the preview for the SVG. The first thing to do is opening an SVG tag, and in case of standalone files, setting the XML namespace is required. Next, we are going to add a full-size rectangle that will act as a canvas. Then we set up a filter tag which we apply on the rectangle. Now it's time to paint something on the canvas using filter effects. Instead of manually coding some random shapes as the islands, we will leverage a filter effect called turbulence. feTurbulence generates Perlin noise, and Perlin noise is a pretty good ingredient for approximating a lot of shapes in nature. Let's add it as the first child of the filter tag. Now this seemingly didn't do anything, but that's because the base frequency isn't specified. This attribute determines how often the noise features should occur. Based on my experience, 0.01 is a good starting value. The turbulent noise is one of the two types this filter primitive can produce. I don't like the distinct glowy white lines, and it's not a very useful feature for the island group. Let's use the other noise type called fractal noise. What we get looks like a colorful mess, but actually it is four layers of noise blended. The layers are the RGBA channels with their own unique patterns. Let's isolate these channels to have a clearer picture. With the color matrix filter effect, we can turn on or off individual channels or even mix them in various ways. Let's set one up with zeros as initial values. With all zeros, the matrix outputs a black image but with zero opacity. Let's make sure the image is fully opaque. The simplest way to do that is setting the last value of the matrix to 1. This represents the constant offset in the calculation of the alpha. Now we see a black image because all the color channels are turned off. Let's turn on the red channel by setting the first value to 1. We just made the filter pass the red input to the red output. We can also pass it to the green output by moving this 1 to the second row. Now we see the same pattern but with a different tint. However, for our goal, we need the same pattern on each color channel. So let's set the first elements of the first three rows to 1. What we did was basically routing the red input to the red, green, and blue outputs, making our image grayscale. We could have used the green or blue or even alpha input instead of red by setting the ones in the second, third, or fourth column. I only chose red because it's the first channel, but see how the other inputs produce different patterns. The result is gradient noise. And if we understand a little detail about it, we can use it to our advantage. Consider the linear gradient, where in the simplest case there's a starting color and an ending color. Between these two, the color value is interpolated based on the distance. We could say that color is gradually changing along a straight line. Now take a look at our noise. Can't we identify little parts where color is gradually changing along an almost straight line? See the five unmasked sections. Don't they look like they are tiny linear gradients? We can even determine their directions. Each of the arrows point from the darker starting color to the brighter ending color. It seems like the gradient noise is made from millions or maybe infinite number of linear gradients. This means they must share a lot of attributes. One thing most people like to do working with linear or even radial or conical gradients is trying out different color palettes. So how could we do that in our case? SVG has a filter effect called component transfer, which provides capabilities for altering channel values in various ways. Let's add the feComponentTransfer tag. The transfer functions per channel are defined as the children of this filter effect, and if one's missing, the channel value will be passed through unaltered. Let's add the feFunkR, feFunkG, and feFunkB as the children. As the names suggest, they are responsible for the red, green, and blue transfer functions. What we are looking to do here is called gradient mapping, where we map from one gradient, namely from the black to white, to another one, which we are still figuring out. The fitting transfer function type here is called table. It's short for lookup table. In this type, we set some control values, start, mid, and endpoints, and anything in between will be interpolated just like in a gradient. We can't set the positions though, so every point will be equidistant from its neighbors. Let's add the table values attribute with 5 zeros to each of the children. Of course, this made the image black, but we are just about to set some colors. Notice how we kept the number of the control points the same along the channels. Only this way can we specify the RGB colors at the control positions. Another thing to keep in mind is that filters usually work in the linear RGB color space. This is slightly different from the better known RGB space of the web. For now, we only need to know that the value range of the channels go from 0 to 1 instead of 0 to 255. Let's start simple and use basic colors for the control points. Black, blue, green, red, and white. We have to think in verticals here. Each column is a color definition. The first color is black. That's 3 zeros. We already have that in the first column, so nothing to do here. Next is blue. Of course, we only need to set the value in the third row to 1. Some blue emerged, but let's keep going. The third color is green, so we set the value in the second row to 1. Now green emerged. Next, we need to specify red in the fourth column. Here we set the value in the first row to 1. It's getting colored. The last one is white, which means we set all three values to 1. So this is a simplified demonstration of gradient mapping. Notice how the start and end colors don't really appear. This has nothing to do with gradient mapping. This is caused by the characteristics of the source. The various shades aren't evenly distributed in our noise. The wide mid-range is overrepresented, while the low-end and high-end ranges are a bit underrepresented. The emerged shapes aren't really reminding me of islands, so let's do something about them. One thing I like to see more of is rugged outlines. The shapes are too smooth, and they don't feel like they would occur in nature. Luckily, feTurbulence has an attribute called num octaves, which we can use to increase detail. It simply adds further octaves to our bass noise. Let's increase it step by step until we find a value that works. I think 5 looks good. You can go above or below, but keep in mind that more octaves means more CPU load. On the other hand, the effect of each further octave is halved. I tend to use 5 as a soft limit, that's good enough for most projects, and 9 as a hard limit, which is the highest single digit value. I believe we have nailed down the form. It's time to fix those colors. Let's talk about height maps for a moment, and let's clear the table values for that. Height maps or bump maps are usually two-dimensional images where the color of the pixels represent a height value. Many times, height data can be encoded into the alpha channel instead. We have a grayscale image in our case. We can take the brightness of each pixel and consider it as a height value. A straightforward approach is making black the lowest point and white the highest point. Now all we need to do is to associate a few terrain types to a few heights and we have our map done. For example, here are some reasonable choices from low to high. Deep blue and aqua blue for deep and shallow water, sand color for sand, light green for underbrush, and dark green for trees. This part is a little messy because the color values have to be in linear RGB, and generally you would pick colors in standard RGB. I made a color converter tool which you can use following the second link in the description. Alternatively, you can just use the values I picked, which you can also find in the description. As you can see, I've used 12 control points, which might be overdone, but this is where it felt right to me. Feel free to experiment with potential different gradients. To avoid the difficulties of thinking in linear RGB, I would suggest setting up a radial gradient in CSS and finding your own palette there first. Then head over to the converter and convert the colors. Time to create a million alternative archipelagos. If you remember, we already talked about one way of creating alternative versions, that is, where we put the ones in a different column of the color matrix. However, feTurbulence has a much powerful and simpler to use attribute called seed. It's the seed value used by the underlying random generator. You can specify any integer between 1 and 16 million to generate a unique noise pattern and hence a unique archipelago. Four times 16 million makes 64 million different variations. Feel free to find your favorite one. Another numbers topic is the size of the file. We already kept it pretty short, but we can further minify it with SVGO. I have it installed on my machine, so I will just use the command line version. It eliminated the unnecessary whitespace and shortened the ID of the filter, reducing the size to 541 bytes. And that's it! We just made a quite capable map generator in around half of a kilobyte. You can check out the code following the CodePen link in the description. Thanks for watching and see you next time!